very happy to welcome everyone to this first session of the afternoon sessions. And this one is on authors, texts, and Islamic scholarship. I'm not going to take very much time to introduce the speakers, to allow the most time for them to speak and then to have discussion. There's longer descriptions of each of them. Let me just introduce their names and where they're at, and then a little bit about the format. So first speaker will be Mauro Nobili, who is the assistant professor of history at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Then Noah Salomon, who is an associate professor of religion at Carleton College. And then Oludamini, Ogunnaike, who is an assistant professor of religion at the College of William and Mary. And then finally, the last speaker will be Farah El-Sharif, who is a PhD student here at Harvard University. Each of the speakers will speak for 20 minutes, and then we'll have time for a common question and answer period and also discussion. So with that, please join me in welcoming Mauro Nobili.
Hello, good afternoon. I have the complicated task to keep you alive and awake after lunch, so believe me, I'll do my best. I want to start, as usual, thanking Professors Mankan and Matthew for making this possible and for allowing me to talk in this prestigious venue. So my presentation is titled The 19th Century Political Project, Nuhubun Tahir's Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. So for those of you who are familiar with West Africa, the title already sounds a little bit strange because everybody knows that the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh allegedly was written 16th, 17th century by somebody else. But my point is that this is not true. So the aim of today's presentation is to start introducing what we can call the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh studies, and this echoing the idea of Tombuctu studies that Professor Kane has in his latest book, Beyond Tombuctu. And then I will locate myself in this scholarship, contributing by saying that the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh is actually a 19th century political project in support of the legitimacy of Ahmed Lobo, the Caliph of Hamdallahi, that we about whom we heard already something today in the morning. When I sent an article a couple of years ago, somebody sent me back a comment saying that my article was basically trying to tackle problems in 1 year, 100 years of misunderstanding of the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. So this misunderstanding actually starts with the conquest of Tombuctu. So late 1893, Tombuctu was taken over by the French, and almost immediately after that, Le Figaro, very famous French newspaper, sent this guy, Félix Dubois, to document Tombuctu. He published this article, Le Figaro à Tombuctu, but most important, his very famous book, Tombuctu, la Mystérieuse. It is the first time, actually, that a European would extensively comment on the length, I mean, on the big libraries of Tombuctu scholars, of course using racist and outdated terminology, but I really like this quote of Dubois, who says that learned doctors of Tombuctu were, to use an expression which might appear strange when applied to Negroes, bibliophiles. The libraries of Tombuctu might be said to have included almost the whole of the Arabian literature. But the very book that attracted Dubois' attention was the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. I have the quote here from the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh that, in fact, Dubois couldn't obtain, and he called him the phantom book of the Sudan. But in a way, Dubois was so important because he was the first who sketched the main understanding of the chronicle that for 100 years have been repeated by scholars, meaning that the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh was a chronicle originally written in the 16th, maybe according to somebody 17th century, that tells the story of the Middle Niger up to the 16th, 17th century, which has been slightly modified in the 19th century. So from Dubois, there we have a long list of scholars who contributed to the topic, including the famous Orientalist Octave Houdas and Marcel de la Fosse, who edited a very problematic version of the text. And unfortunately, the new edition of the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh by a team of scholars led by Abdul Qadir Maiga in Tombuctu doesn't really fix the problem of these editions. Then we have several other scholars, like John Anwick, Nehemiah Levzion, Madina Lital, etc., who contributed to the topic. But they more or less followed in footsteps by basically saying that the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh was an original old chronicle polluted by later accretions. Okay, and I have this quote that I really find fitting here by Augustine Hall, who says that this approach is actually in line, and I quote, with the scholarship on West African written sources, I quote, characterized by a heavy reliance on textual evidence, which is studied following, above all, a philological approach. The approach aims to retrieve the original or archetypal frame of historical documents, which are therefore considered to have been corrupted by lengthy series of interpolation and or copyist mistakes. In doing so, inconsistencies and contradictions discovered are relegated to the status of accident in the chain of transmission of historical information. But as a historian, and as many historians here, we know a very famous statement by Mark Bloch, and I quote it again, apology, who says that to establish the fact of a forgery is not enough. It is further necessary to discover its motivation. Above all, Bloch continues, a fraud is in its way a piece of evidence. Merely to prove that the famous structure of Charlemagne to the Church of Aix-la-Chapelle is not authentic is to avoid an error, but not to acquire knowledge. On the other hand, should we succeed in proving that the forgery was committed by the followers of Frederick Barbarossa and that it was designed to implement dreams of imperial grandeur, we open new vistas upon the vast perspectives of history. So basically, what I'm doing with the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh is not looking for a romantic original. I don't really care about the original. What I'm looking for is the forgery. So what is this 19th century layer of writing in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh that we need to understand? What does it tell us about the history of 19th century West Africa? All these so-called forged parts points to the Caliphate of Andalahi and to Ahmed Lobo. The Caliphate of Andalahi, for those who are not familiar with the region, is an early 19th century Islamic state in the middle Niger, more or less in what is contemporary central Mali. But what is the starting point of this research? The starting point is in the actual edition by De La Fosse and Houdas, 1913, that is a pastiche, is a disaster. Because by a closer analysis, Houdas and De La Fosse actually conflated two different texts, one embodied in two of the three manuscripts they used. That is an incomplete 17th century chronicle that, for a lack of a better title, and following on Nehemiah Levzion's ideas, I call the Tārīkh ibn al-Mukhtar. The only thing we know is the name of the author, the son of al-Mukhtar. And what I call the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, the 19th century apocryphal work. So by taking out of the edition only the sections that belong to manuscript C, we actually have a new text, the real Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, the real 19th century Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. I don't really have all the time here to explain you philologically how we can split these two texts. But I have a smoking gun here that is a manuscript that I found in Paris in the De Gironco collection, which is quite explicit. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ada Tārīkh lil-Fakih Nuh ibn Tahir ibn Musa, Talmid Shaykh Sidi al-Mukhtar al-Kunti, wa sammaytuhu Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. This is the chronicle by Nuh ibn Tahir, and I called it Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. And then it goes on and on and on with many of the things that we know from the edited edition. Then last night when I first came here, I was kind of surprised that the guy who was in possession of these manuscripts is on the poster of today's conference. I don't know if you pick it up from my first book or whatever. But this guy,
you have dreams of what.
Yeah, we heard it this morning. Yeah.
I had a dream that this would be needed. That's
what. It is definitely needed. So this guy, Yusuf bin al-Khalil, was a Songhai scholar active in the early 1910s in what is today's Niger. Anyway, let's go back to the main topic. If we take the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh as a 19th century construction, we mainly focus on what is a rhetorical tool that goes throughout the narrative, that is a prophecy. Everybody knows this prophecy if you're familiar with West African historiography. It is a prophecy that is foretold to the famous Askalaj Muhammad, the king of Songhai, who went to the pilgrimage at the end of the 15th century and was foretold four times the arrival of Ahmed Lobo. So in the 15th century, it's foretold the arrival of Ahmed Lobo in the 19th century by several people. There is a fictional Sharif of Mecca, Jalal ad-Din al-Suyuti, al-Maghili, and even the king of the jinns, Shamharush. All these very authoritative personalities agree that Ahmed Lobo is the inheritor of Askalaj Muhammad. And the identification is not explicit, but I would say it's almost explicit. If we go and read details about how was this, you know, foretold caliph, in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, we read that his name will be Ahmed, will be the son of Muhammad, will be from the Sangare Fulani tribe. His power would emerge at the beginning of the 13th century of Hijra in the region of Sebera. What do we know about Ahmed Lobo? Ahmed was Ibn Muhammad. He was of the Sangare Fulani tribe, that is a subgroup of the Bari group. The Caliphate of Handalai emerged in Sebera, between the Bani and the Niger, so in central Mali, when at the beginning of the 19th century, that correspond to the 13th century of Hijra. So you can see that the identification of the prophesized caliphate with Ahmed Lobo is quite explicit. The point of this forgery, which I actually call a political project, not a forgery per se, is to construct a sophisticated, reliable legitimacy for somebody like Ahmed Lobo, who emerges basically out of the blue. He was not part of the Muslim establishment of the time. He was not part of the families that traditionally have been the repository of political power. And its legitimacy have been contested several times by people within the Caliphate of Hamdallahi, like the famous revolt of Gelagio, that was a Fulani local leader. He would be sometimes in troubles with the powerful Muslim family of the Kunta in Tombuctú, especially with one of its most representative, Muhammad al-Kunti, who was quite, strong against Ahmed Lobo, especially because the Kunta were trading in tobacco, and Ahmed Lobo claimed that tobacco was haram. But also with the people of Sokoto. The people of Sokoto didn't really like the emergence of a very powerful state, basically a couple of hundred miles to the west of Sokoto. So in front of all these attacks to the legitimacy of Ahmed Lobo, the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh was produced as a literary tool that provided this legitimacy that was lacking to Ahmed Lobo. Ahmed Lobo is transformed in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh always by this meta-historical identification as inheritor of Askia Muhammad, as a sultan. Because Nuh ibn Tahir, the author of the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, the real, according to my theory, author of the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, borrows from the 17th century Tārīkh genre a sort of teleological narrative of secular rulers of West Africa that has been wonderfully described by Paulo Farias in his path-breaking work, the Arabic medieval inscriptions from the Republic of Mali. But of course, via the prophecy, Ahmed Lobo becomes the inheritor of Askia Muhammad. And in this way, the apogee of this 1,000-year-long tradition of secular ruler of West Africa. But when I use sultan, I'm actually avoiding to use any kind of religious loaded term. But he was also a caliph. When I use caliph in this case, on the contrary, I'm strongly, identifying this second layer of legitimacy with Islam. A well-known hadith says that religion will remain upright until there will be 12 caliphs under whom the entire ummah unites. Scholars have always disagreed about who are these caliphs. apart from the very first ones. So what happens in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh? Nuh ibn Ṭāhir makes authorities agreeing that Aske Muhammad was the 11th of these caliphs, and of course Ahmed Lobbo, inheritor of Aske Muhammad, will be the 12th. But that's not enough, because another well-known hadith talks about al-Mujaddid al-Din, the renewer of the faith. So God will send to this community at the turn of every century someone who will restore the religion. So in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, Ahmed Lobbo also becomes Mujaddid, renewer of the faith. But now, let's be a little bit more concrete. Can we really imagine people circulating like hundreds of pages, manuscripts, and looking, you know, between the pages for the legitimacy of Ahmed Lobbo? It's unlikely. What really circulated was actually a series of smaller documents, sort of dispatch, that were circulated and read in public, as we can see from the colophon of some of these manuscripts. So messengers will go around and read aloud these proclamations, in which we have basically the reference to Ahmed Lobbo as the legitimate caliph of West Africa. This document is very famous. It's called Risala fi Dhuhur al-Khalifa Thani Ashar. And I think it's one of the most popular and widespread documents in West Africa. I find it in every manuscript library that I ended up taking a look at. But of course, there is one piece that is important, is to link back these claims to the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. And I mean, I'm quite excited about that, but I still find this sentence over here one of the best pieces of West African literature. Because we can read here, Inqila Aynal Mustaq. So if somebody asks me, where is the proof that he is the caliph? Qultu nas Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. Go and look in the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, and you'll see that my claims are correct. And then it goes on and on and on with long quotations on the Fattāsh, from the Fattāsh, concerning the legitimacy of Ahmed Lobbo. And since I've been quite short, I think I can also kind of introduce another document that I did not put in my slides. That is the only response that I ever found to the claims of the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. And I just do it because it's going to be the topic, this character is going to be the topic of the next presentation. Abdul Qadir Dantafa, a scholar related to the Sokoto court, would write a very harsh response to this very document by basically saying, my brother, no, all your claims are completely nonsense. And the very way in which the claims are disputed is not because it's unlikely, not because there is anything wrong in the hadith, but simply because the quotations from as-Suyūti that are the strongest part of the argument of the Fattāsh are wrong. So Abdul Qadir Dantafa dismisses this document on the basis of issues related to wrong quotations that I find extremely fascinating. And the authority of Ahmed Lobbo is also extended to the very body of his subjects, because one of the pieces that I have not included in the presentation today, 5 minutes, plenty of time, is about the ownership of the caliph over several qabail, so quotes, tribes from West Africa, usually endogamous groups, that were considered as property of the king. And again, to go back in the field, how were these things received? First of all, we have several fatwas that use the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, so historical text, as a juridical precedent to justify enslavement of groups of people. That I also find an extremely interesting and fascinating topic. And the German explorer Heinrich Barth actually found on the eastern part of the Niger Bend entire groups of people running away from the areas controlled by Ahmed Lobbo because they have been reduced into slaves. So this was something that was actually happening on the ground. So basically concluding, the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh is not a 16th or 17th century chronicle as people have always believed. Its author is not Mahmud Kati, but not even Ibn al-Mukhtar, as Nehemiah Levtzion advanced in his seminar articles. The Tārīkh al-Fattāsh is an apocryphal chronicle written in the 19th century by Nobili ibn Tahir by modifying the pre-existing Tārīkh ibn al-Mukhtar and ascribing this text to Mahmud Kati. And in this we go back to the issue of intertextuality that we discussed this morning with Terem, Professor Terem, because this reshaping of the text creates a new text. So to intertextuality, there is a stronger relationship with issues of authorship. So it is not the percentage of text between the Fattāsh and the Tārīkh ibn al-Mukhtar that is different. Most of the time, they are the same. But it's the overall preconceived plan that transforms, by changing pieces, the Tārīkh ibn al-Mukhtar into the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh. So the Tārīkh ibn al-Mukhtar, the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, as I imagine it, this apocryphal 19th century chronicle, reconstructs the legitimacy of Ahmed Lobo in three different levels. As the inheritor of Askia Muhammad, as a legitimate temporal ruler of West Africa. As the 12th caliph mentioned by the Prophet in a very famous hadith, and as the Mujaddid al-Din, the renewer of the faith. This is why, so far, the title of my upcoming book, A Sultan, Caliph, and Renewer of the Faith, Ahmed Lobo, the Tārīkh al-Fattāsh, and the Making of an Islamic State in 19th Century West Africa. Thank you very much.
So next, Noah Salomon will speak.
Well, we go from one Noah to another Noah. I'm afraid I'm not bin Tahir, though. One moment. Well, while I'm getting this up on the screen, I really would like to thank both Professor Khan and Matthew for organizing what's so far been such a wonderful conference. It's really great to be here with all of you and to hear such exciting work on these topics. It would come as no surprise to anyone in this room to say that the general and I think sloppy juxtaposition made between people in historical studies and those in the social sciences is that the former rely on texts and the philological sciences to produce meaning, while the latter make use of people to do the same. Like most stereotypes, however, this one too needs serious revising, both in terms of the object of our respective studies and in regard to the epistemological foundations of our respective quests for knowledge about Islamic Africa, its presence, and its pasts. In the case of the former, the object of our studies, of course, historians range from intellectual to social history and much in between, and social scientists and cultural theorists have had a long-standing interest in the textual cultures and reading publics, inspired in great part by the work of scholars in literary studies like Walter Ong and Marshall McLuhan, and working through to more contemporary figures from Benedict Anderson to Brinkley Messick. As for the latter, the epistemological foundations of our quest for knowledge, any trover of the archives knows only too well the way in which social norms and political circumstances intervene between the text and scholars' access to it, from what people choose to preserve and copy and put in libraries and archives to the often liberal evidence for it in Quran and Sunnah, but it is in fact a process that the Muslim attains through successive ritual acts with the goal of purification of the self. He writes in the next quote that you have behind me, you advance every day a degree on the stairs of Tawheed, and in doing so you add to your concept of Tawheed new aspects. It will not take an insignificant amount of time for you to become, with the might of God and his good fortune and his praise, someone who truly embraces Tawheed, for each day you increase your religion. The evidence for Tawheed is plenty in the Quran. If attaining that knowledge was merely like the work of the textual archaeologist, as one scholar of Salafism has described their hermeneutics, it wouldn't take much digging to find these artifacts. Yet Abdurrahman ibn al-Khaliq sees the grasping of Tawheed to require much more work than mere cognitive assent. A progressive process of moral cleansing, which seems to be a daily and never-ending struggle, is necessary in order to truly understand this primary element of Salafi Aqidah. Despite the Salafis portrayed everywhere as scripturalists par excellence, it appears here in Abdurrahman ibn al-Khaliq's text that the texts are not just not enough, but entirely inert, without a process of ethical training that is generally completely left out in discussions of Salafism. How do Salafi texts move from inert connections of ink and paper to attain meaning then? What are the intersubjective ways Salafi texts come to take on force within the communities in which they circulate? What does it mean to read a text within Salafism given that practices of private reading jostle alongside recitation, qira'ah, and even, as I mentioned at the outset of this presentation, incantation, ruqya? What is the force of the reading context in which the text is encountered? And Sa'ad al-Sunnah has no more central of a location for engagement with text than its multiple, informal, and open to the public lessons it holds in its central mosque complex in Khartoum's suburb of Sajana. One lesson circle that I have attended frequently over the years is the Sira lesson run by one of the leaders of Ansar al-Sunnah, Sheikh Kamal Omar Bilal. The lesson happens each Saturday for a little over an hour in the space between al-Maghrib and al-Isha prayers and consists of reading the well-known modern abridged Sira text, Ar-Rahīq al-Makhtūm, by the Indian scholar Safiya Rahman Mubarak Puri. Learning of this lesson circle while talking to the Shaykh, I, the ever-eager student, went down to the bookstore and got myself a copy, ready to study the text with the Shaykh. Yet when I got to the lesson, I was the only student with the text in hand. All other students sat on the floor listening along. My first and rather silly reaction amounted to some sort of economic analysis. Perhaps the purchase of the text was prohibitively expensive. What I came to realize, though, was something rather different. Reading of the text took up roughly 10 to 20 minutes of the 1 hour and 15 minute session. And the commentary on the text and what it might mean for a modern Sudanese person took up the rest of the time. Getting through maybe only 4 pages of the text in each sitting, it would take nearly 2 years to read through the whole Sira, even in this highly abridged version. For those of you who have seen this one, it's not very long. The text was serving here less as a narrative to be read, for of course most adult Sudanese would know the details of the Sira, than as a series of notes that jog the memory of the teacher whose interest extended beyond explication of the text alone, a mnemonic device of sorts. Instead, the focus of the lesson circle was how the spirit of the Sira could be lived. The text served as a guide and grounding for sure, but only came into life in conversation with the lives of the Sudanese men it addressed on those Saturday evenings. Here the text was certainly present, but only as a first step in a process which, in which attaining the correct relationship to the text, learning how to take the text seriously, was an intermediate goal, and then understanding what the text might mean for the Muslim today was the end goal. Students came not merely to hear the text, which of course they could read on their own, the book was in fact inexpensive, downloadable on the internet, etc. Nor did they come, I think, to hear Kamal's interpretation of it, though this was important too. Rather, they came for the commentarial apparatus that surrounded the text, the moral lessons that the Shaykh expounded for how to live a good life on the basis of the ultimate good life, that of the Prophet. Far from a scripturalism in which the text would supplant human authority, as is often argued about the Salafis and the Islamic revival in general, it was the human reader, Sheikh Kamal, who realized the text's potential as something with a message and force on 21st century life. Here it seems clear that textual authority does not come at the expense of human authority, as the scripturalism thesis assumes from Geertz really until today, but rather only emerges through it. Lesson circles like these do not peter out with the mass production of texts and the increase in education. 5 minutes, thanks. Rather, it becomes an ever more important place to make meaning anew out of these texts, made possible by human authority rather than supplanting it. Such cultures of reading are not unique to Islam. In his now classic edited volume, The Ethnography of Reading, Jonathan Boyarin writes of the intersubjectivism of the reading process of a yeshiva class of which he is a part. I'm quoting here, the voices in the text proper and around the voices of the commentary, the text, are mutually dependent and coexistent. Without the text, we who constitute the class would have no basis for dialogue among ourselves. However, Without us, the rabbi's inscribed words would remain only potential, end quote. If we are to extend such a recognition to the Salafi lesson circles I have described, I think we should, we are forced to destabilize the notion forwarded both by Salafis and by those who study them alike, that for Salafis, tradition is a fixed body of work that they are able to resuscitate, dusting it off and presenting it unscathed to the present. Rather, tradition here is the continuing elaboration of the text through determining its center and what that means to our present circumstances. The text here is a partner in dialogue rather than an object to be displayed in some sort of fiqh museum. To conclude, in this paper I've made two arguments about Salafi engagements with texts. One, that knowledge acquisition among Salafi is often understood to be a mechanical process of searching for proof texts, what Salafis themselves call istidlal, cannot be understood outside of Salafi ritual and ethical practice, which Salafis themselves, and crucially, not just the social scientists, see as a necessary prerequisite to any acquisition of knowledge or to its proper use. Salafi pedagogy pays as much attention to the correct formation of the learning subject as to the knowledge itself, to the mad'u', the recipient of dawah, as to the da'i, the propagator. In other words, Salafi writings on knowledge transmission pay attention to the heart as much as they do to the mind, to ethics as much as they do to reason. This former category has gone almost entirely unstudied in analyses of contemporary Salafi movements, where their proponents are understood to be primarily archaeologists of meaning, upholding the text at the expense of human authority. The second point I wanted to make is that the relationship between text and Salafi knowledge is poorly understood, given the literalist manner in which scholars of Salafism understand Salafi claims about scriptural authority. Attention to textual practices, that is, the means by which texts are read, recited, circulated, purposed, and repurposed, reveals that texts are mediated by a whole host of non-textual knowledges within Salafi practice, and that those texts are therefore not understandable without an understanding of how those procedures work. If this is true, then historians and social scientists of Islamic Africa who work on texts indeed have a lot to talk about. And it's my hope that fora like these spark further conversations. Thanks.
Our next speaker is Oludamini Ogunnaike.
Thank you very much. I'm going to load my presentation now. And as I do so, I wanted to follow suit and thank Professor Khan and Matthew profusely for organizing this and bringing me back to my alma mater and getting together so many great minds and great projects in one place. It's a real joy to be here. My presentation is entitled Philosophical Sufism in the Sokoto Caliphate. The life and works of Shaykh Dan Tafa, as Mauro told you. This figure is an early scholar of the Sokoto Caliphate, and I think he's very important for a number of reasons, which we'll get into. I wanted to also begin with special thanks to Muhammad Sharif of the Sankore Institute for making these works available. He's worked for years and years and years, a kind of independent scholar who's now based in Mali, worked for years and years and years digitizing and collecting manuscripts from the Sokoto Caliphate and putting them up on his website so I can sit in my bedroom and read and translate them without having to go to archival collections. But I may have to do that later to track down a few more works. All right, so the study of the intellectual traditions in sub-Saharan Africa have been deeply influenced by two theses. The first thesis is one of general and of intellectual decline. Now, it's broadly been discredited or argued against in the field of Islamic studies, but it still has a lot of weight and pull and influence. The thesis of intellectual decline is that from the grand golden age, where you have these lofty and daring metaphysical thinkers, Fakhreddin Razi, Ghazali, Ibn Arabi, Suhrawardi, people like this, Ibn Rushd, that was the golden age, and everything kind of declined into people merely repeating things and being more conservative and, frankly, not as interesting or intellectually sophisticated. Characteristic of this thesis was the notion that Ibn Rushd was the last Islamic philosopher, a notion that was so widespread in the early European literature in the 20th century that even many Arab scholars adopted it themselves. And that's why you have conferences on Ibn Rushd, and everybody loves Ibn Rushd because he was the last great philosopher that the Arabs supposedly had. More recently, this has been updated to say, okay, maybe Ibn Rushd, or sometimes extended to Ibn Khaldun, was the last philosopher of the Islamic West. Now, I should say here, by what I mean by philosophy is not interesting into what we call philosophy here in the department at Harvard, but specifically the discipline of falsafa, which is Greek, then taken up by Avicenna in particular, or Aristotelian philosophy. So there are many disciplines that continue to thrive in the Islamic West. There's relatively uncontroversially logic, certain branches of kalam, and Sufism, theology and Sufism, whose arguments would be considered philosophical by almost anyone today, but they're not part of the discipline called falsafa. So I want to specify that. So this thesis is still around that Ibn Rushd or Ibn Khaldun was kind of the last main exponent of falsafa in the Islamic West. The tradition continued in the Islamic East, especially in Iran, but kind of died out everywhere else. Then another corollary of this thesis of intellectual decline is that philosophical Sufism of people like Ibn Arabi, Ibn Sabain, Al-Harali, and other scholars who combined mystical experience with very sophisticated rational proofs and argumentation gave way to a more pietistic, magical, and political Sufism from the 15th century onward. Again, this was a thesis that was widespread for the whole Islamic world, and then as people became more aware of traditions in Iran and Syria and other places, and the Ottoman world was still limited to the North Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa. So there's still a kind of thesis that this philosophical Sufism somewhat died out in the Islamic West, migrated east as a number of these scholars in the 13th century, like all of these scholars I mentioned, Ibn Arabi, Ibn Sabain, Harali, they all moved from Andalusia to Egypt and Syria, that with them, the tradition went east and never came back to the West. Coupled with, so that's the thesis of intellectual decline. The other thesis is that of Islam Noir, which most of you here are very familiar with, but I'll reiterate it, is that Africans, racially and culturally, are essentially predisposed towards magical, mystical forms of religion, whereas Arabs and other white groups, are ethnic groups, are more predisposed to rational, textual, and intellectual forms of religious practice and life. And so that Islam in Africa, amongst black Africans especially, is naturally syncretic and magical and mystical and not intellectual and rational. So these two theses have, although you'd be hard-pressed to find a scholar, especially a scholar of Islam in Africa today, that would agree with them in their entirety, has structured the way in which a lot of research in our field has been done. So for example, scholars of Islamic intellectual history in general, especially scholars of philosophical Sufism or philosophy, tend to ignore Sub-Saharan Africa completely. Whereas scholars of Islam in Africa tend to neglect the philosophical dimensions of the works of Sub-Saharan African scholars, focusing instead on their historical, political, or legal writings and what these can tell us about their social historical context, not just for the sake of the ideas themselves. Now, the case why I find Sheikh Dantafa so interesting is he completely bucks this trend. Okay, so first, a little bit about Sheikh Dantafa. He was born to Malam Tafa, who was one of Sheikh Uthman Danfodio, the leader of the jihad, Sokoto jihad, and founder of the Sokoto Caliphate, to one of his right-hand men, Malam Tafa, and Khadija, who was the eldest daughter of Uthman Danfodio. And he was born right on the eve of the Hijra, Uthman Danfodio's Hijra, from Degel. In fact, one account says that Uthman Danfodio actually delayed the Hijra that began the jihad of the Sokoto Caliphate to allow his daughter to give birth to Dantafa. So he kind of is coextensive with the literally the son of the Sokoto Caliphate. He was born when the Sokoto Caliphate was born, the very day. He began his spiritual training under his maternal uncle, Muhammad Sanbu, who was another son of Uthman Danfodio, famed for his asceticism and spiritual prowess. It said that Uthman Danfodio would come to his son, Muhammad Sanbu, before battles to ask for his du'as for victory. So he began his spiritual training with Muhammad Sambo at the age of 15. I was done, achieved the status of a sheikh at age 18, and then was instructed to complete further study in the outward sciences. He studied a wide array of disciplines: logic, mathematics, poetry, medicine, natural and occult sciences, grammar, jurisprudence, hadith, theology, and many more disciplines with his father, Muhammad Bello, and other famous scholars of the Sokoto Caliphate of the period. He was put in charge of his father's school in Salome, which is a few kilometers from Sokoto, upon his father's death when he was about 40 years old. And then 20 years later, he died at 60 and was buried behind the school. Heinrich Barth, who was mentioned before, met him in 1853 and described him as the most learned of the present generations of the inhabitants of Sokoto, on whose stores of knowledge I drew eagerly. And he has a quote here that actually may be somewhat related to this Tārīkh al-Fattāsh question. Barth says, he made the acquaintance of Abdul Qadir Dantafa, paid me a visit in the evening, and furnished me immediately with some positive data regard to the history of the dynasty of the Askia, the ruler of Songhai, which he had perfectly in his head, and which were of the greatest importance in giving me insight into the historical relation of the Western countries and their regions with that of the central Negro land. It's from Barth's Travels and Discoveries. So he was known and famous. He's been known to Western literature since the 19th century, but there really haven't been any substantial studies on him other than one article and thesis by Nigerian scholar Ahmed Kani. Okay, so Dantafa's works. He authored a series of elegies and biographies of his teachers and family members and other prominent scholars of the early Sokoto Caliphate. He's most famous for his historical works, which are histories of the Sokoto Caliphate, Raudat, Mausufat al-Sudan and Raudat al-Afqar, which are cited in a number of different sources about the Sokoto Caliphate. Murray Last takes a lot of his work on the Sokoto Caliphate from these two sources of his. He wrote a number of legal works, including a very popular one on differences of opinion between Sheikh Uthman Danfodio and his brother, Abdullahi Danfodio, over certain issues. He wrote a number of works on the natural and occult sciences, and they weren't really separate for him. The work of physics, so natural philosophy, as widely considered, included both what we would call today physics and medicine, and as well these occult sciences, the esoteric properties of plants, minerals, talismans, and things like that. Interestingly, he seems to have written some works of philosophy. By philosophy, I mean falsafa, and he sometimes uses the term hikmah for this, and we'll get into that distinction later. He wrote some works of practical Sufism, how you actually do Sufi things, and then some works of theoretical Sufism and theology, works about metaphysics, about cosmology, that would engage in these kind of very sophisticated philosophical arguments for certain positions on metaphysical issues. Now, this is my classification of his works, looking at Tonwick's ALA and the list of all his works, plus the list of works collected by Muhammad Sharif and the Sankore Institute. This is how I roughly divide up his works. Dantafa, however, categorizes his works in a different way, which can be seen in this remarkable poem that he wrote towards the end of his life called Shukr al-Wahib. And he said he wrote this poem to give thanks to God for the many sciences which he had been blessed to learn, master, receive. And this is the way he categorized them. He has this sixth part. It's a poem of about 67, 66 lines, and begins with, "I begin in the name of the creator of the lights, in the veil of the hearts and insights." He always writes kind of like this. The first category of sciences and knowledge that he talks about are the sciences of Sharia. Included in these are linguistic sciences, jurisprudence, fiqh, theology, kalam, sunnah, tafsir, Quranic interpretation, hermeneutics, diraya, general kind of transmitted learning, and the Sufism of ethics, tasawuf at-takhalluq, ethical formation, character purification. And he said these he acquired by transmission, memorization, diligence, and study. The second class of sciences or knowledge that he acquired, he calls the sciences of the ancients, ulum al-awa'il, which include medicine, and these are sciences that have their origins in pre-Islamic civilizations, generally the Greek, Indian. Medicine, arithmetic, logic, astronomy and astrology, physics, magic squares, letters, and various types of divination, khata, ramal, these tables, ziyaraj, and other things. And he says he required these by transmission, and some by independent study. The next is what he calls the science of the realities, ulum al-haqa'iq, which includes the science of the manifestation of divine names and qualities, the mother of the book, spirits, the realm of the malakut, which is this kind of spiritual realm, but it's still formal, the realm of the jabarut above that, which is super formal spiritual realm. And he said he acquired these sciences through realization, tahqiq, and elevation, taraki. Then we have this, what he calls the sciences of the saints, ulum al-awliya, which he says characterizes the knowledge of the mysteries of the Sufi path, so he calls it, the experiences of actually walking on the Sufi path, jalb, fana, annihilation. Then he has these symbolic names, the white pearl, the noon, the tablet, and the pen, the lo tree. And he says these are acquired through suluk, actually traveling on the Sufi path, and jalb, experiencing that divine attraction which is supposed to accompany traveling on the spiritual path. Then, interestingly, the fifth science, or the science of mysteries, asrar, from outside of the Sufi path. So you have mysteries, knowledge of spiritual things and secrets, but which come from outside of the Sufi path. So this indicates that he's using the term tasawwuf in a much more specific way than is often generally used in other authors, especially in contemporary academic parlance. So these are really even more mysterious, have names like the living water of the spring of Khidr, the Huruf al-Muqatta'at, the famous letters at the beginning of some of the surahs of the Qur'an, the letters of the greatest name of God, and these he said he received by divine bestowal. Then even more esoteric, if I can use that category, that term, he calls what he calls the sciences of the greatest unveiling, which he said none but him and perhaps his teacher have ever even dreamed to acquire, and no one will reveal them except for the seal of Muhammadan sanctity, a term that's very common, coming from Ibn Arabi's hagiology, theory of sainthood, who he identifies with the Mahdi. And this is important because different Sufi groups identify, usually their founders, the Tijani identify the seal of Muhammadan sanctity with Ahmed Tijani. Qadiris have their own various different Shadli authors have claimed this title, but he identifies it with the Mahdi. And he attained these sciences, which is, again, have these elusive names, manifestation of night and the day, sciences of the throne. He declares, and he said he required these through true dreams during sleep without any effort or difficulty. So these are his, this is how he divides up, these are the ways in which he categorizes the knowledge that he acquired, as well as the means of acquiring them. So this is a very useful document. I'm still trying to track down some of the references to these very mysterious living water of Khidr spring. Some of the other ones from the Sufi ones come from standard Sufi terminology and they're easier to explain. But if anyone wants to take a look at this document, I would be very grateful of any help tracking down some of these curious names. Another important work for understanding Sheikh Nantafa's own understanding of his learning and his approach to it is a work he wrote a little bit before the previous poem we discussed. This work is called Uhud wa Mawathik. It's oaths and vows that he took. And it's a collection of oaths and vows he said he took at the hand of the greatest namus, which could be the greatest angel or could be the prophet, which he claims are part of the Muhammadan inheritance, and he wrote them down to encourage others to follow him in taking these oaths. And it begins with a really touching, very nice oath. So I've taken upon myself an oath to spread the wing of mercy to all things in creation, to view them with the same eye which the real viewed them when he desired to create them. I desire good and sympathy for them, to extend affection and kindness to all of them, regardless of their believers, disbelievers, righteous, sinful, human, jinn, animals, plants, stones, or clods of mud. And every day, three times, I invoke, O God, be merciful to the whole of your creation and suffice them where they are incapable. Say this and attend by this oath with the duty of holding back the law from them, the consequence of the law, to the best of my ability. So it begins with this very gentle, nice oath. So these oaths are a series of ethical oaths, but some of them relate to his scholarship. This is what was the one that was most interesting to me. He said, I've taken an oath and covenant not to call anyone from the people to what I've acquired from falsafa, he uses the term falsafa here, philosophy, and the sciences of the ancients, even though I took these sciences in a sound manner, rejecting the erroneous perspectives within them. Along with that, I will not teach these sciences to anyone in order that they may not be led astray, and errors will thus revert back to me. the contrary, I'll call them to knowledge, ma'rifa, the Quran, surah, sunnah, jurisprudence, and Sufism. So he says, I know falsafa, I've studied it, I know it, but I'm not going to teach it to anyone because it's dangerous, they could go astray. I'll talk later about what to make of this oath, because he wrote versified works on falsafa, which means he probably taught them. So maybe he wrote this oath after he taught it. I don't know. It's an interesting mystery. Then he also said, speaking more about what we now call the occult sciences, I've taken an oath not to utilize anything from the sciences of differentiation, spells, incantations, charms, and the subjugation of jinn for either advantage or protection. On the contrary, I've abandoned these altogether, even though I acquired and mastered the essentials of these sciences. So again, I know how to do this, but I'm not going to do it. And then relatedly, and he makes a differentiation between these two things, which in today's academy would just be lumped together into one category of magic. I've taken an oath and covenant in line with the above vow not to implement anything from the science of letters and names, in mahruf wal asma, in a way which could cause harm to the Muslims. However, when it can bring benefit to me, I will use it on the condition of it being appropriate for attracting benefit or defense. So he draws a distinction between al-mahruf, which often in science of letters and magical use and divine names, and these spells, subjugation of jinn, and other things. The former he won't do at all. The other he won't do to harm any Muslims, but he'll do it if it's appropriate. And then finally, this is an interesting one, it's rather long, but he says, I've taken an oath to construct my doctrine upon the verses of the Quran and not upon rational proofs or theological opinions. In this position, I'm a muqallid, a follower, and the source of my following is the infallible Quran. And then he says, if I were asked, for example, for the evidence of the temporal creation of the cosmos, this is a huge debate in Islamic theology and philosophy. The philosophers came down generally, not always on the side of the eternity of the cosmos, and the Islamic theologians came down on the side, generally, on the side of the huduth, the temporal creation of the cosmos, the universe. He said, I wouldn't give this argument. It would take a while to explain what this argument, the temporal creation of the requisite accidents is due to the temporal creation of the essential identities. This is a term from Ibn Arabi, this is an argument from Ibn Arabi's school. It would take a while to kind of unpack it. But I tried to do so on my paper, if you're interested. Nor would I say some other than this from amongst theological perspectives. So I wouldn't try to prove it rationally. Rather, I would say, God says, God is the creator of everything, for there's no evidence for me other than that. Therefore, I would explain this evidence from God having absolute certainty in the reality of the Quran and no other, since I've seen that rational evidence in no way leads to direct ma'rifah, direct knowledge of God. The evidences of reason are limited to establishing the existence of an incomprehensible deity and that its attributes are such and such, but the evidence of reason cannot fathom in any way its essential reality. As for the Quran, it emerged from the presence of God by means of Jibreel to his messenger. That's a matter which is decisive, so realize that. So he gives, again, this is an argument from the Akbari, the Ibn Arabian tradition, and the Ghazali as well, says, if you just have reason, you'll know that there's a God up there who created everything, but you have no idea what he's like. You need something more than reason for that. But this again, is a kind of interesting thing. So he's aware of these rational proofs. He can do them, but he says, I'm not going to use them. All right. So let me then go into just briefly outlining the works which we do have. Most of these I've been able to see, and there are a few of them whose manuscripts I'm still trying to track down. So his works of falsafa, these seem to be works of Avicennan falsafa. Manzuma fil Hikma, it's an introductory poem on philosophy. Futuhat al-Rabaniya, I'm still looking for this work, but Ahmed Khani describes it as a refutation of the naturalist and materialist position on the independence of the world. And Kuliyat al-Alam al-Sitta, which is this interesting short poem. It's kind of a Neo-Pythagorean poem. Oh no, sorry, that's a different one. Kuliyat al-Alam al-Sitta explains various universals, their origin and their return, and has an extended discussion of Hula, prime matter. This poem, Nazm al-Qawaneen al-Wujud, is a poem that has this kind of Pythagorean structure. You start with the one, and then the two, and then three, four, seven, and 12, and how the whole universe comes from these, the manifestation of these numbers. Nasab al-Mawjudat, another similar poem on cosmology. Kashf al-Kunuz wa al-Hilla al-Rumuz. This one could be considered a work of philosophy and or the occult sciences, depending on how you look at it. It's a work explaining the cosmological correspondences of certain talismans. So it's kind of both a work of natural philosophy and of talismanic science. Then we have works of philosophical Sufism, the Manzum al-Istilahat al-Sufiyya, which he wrote when he was 17 years old. It's a poem which explains the difficult technical vocabulary in Abdul Karim Jili's magnum opus in Insan al-Kamil, which is a very amazing critical engagement with Ibn Arabi's work, and there really hasn't been a very, there have been a few doctoral dissertations, but there hasn't been a really good study of this work of Jili's, but it seems to have been very important in spreading the ideas of Ibn Arabi, not just in North and West Africa, but also in Yemen and East Africa and the Malay world as well. So when he was 17, he wrote a poem explaining all of the difficult terminology in this massive work. And Kashf al-Bayan wa liman al-shkala min Kitāb al-Insan. And then he wrote this other work where he clarified 13 difficult topics from within Jili's Insan al-Kamil. Another work, Hadrat al-Hahut wa wahidiyat al-Lahut, a work explaining the difference between the Hahut, a level of the essence, and the Lahut, a presence of divinity, different levels of reality in Ibn Arabi's kind of cosmology. And then another work, Maqamat al-Anbiya, which I'm still trying to find a copy of, but which he says has to do, which he says was divinely inspired, not authored, he just divinely received it, and has to do with different wisdoms of the prophets. Seems to be something akin to Ibn Arabi's Fusus al-Hikam, but I need to get a look at the manuscript to see for sure. Then we have works of practical Sufism, in which he describes how to progress along the Sufi path. Because time is short, I'll skip over them. But they also deal with epistemology and issues of the practical Sufi path, so they're not completely uninteresting for uses of philosophical study of his ideas. Okay, so I'll conclude. From just this brief overview of Dantafa's work, we can see that there existed an Akbari tradition, as a tradition of the school of Ibn Arabi in the Sokoto Caliphate from its very founding. Dantafa says he studied Jili's massive work in Insan al-Kamil with his uncle, Muhammad Sanbu, who in turn studied it with Uthman Danfodio. So the question is, who did Danfodio study Insan al-Kamil with now? And his work seems to suggest that falsafa and hikmah, now the term hikmah is kind of ambiguous. It's sometimes used for these practical occult sciences, and sometimes it's used to refer to kind of speculative Avicennan philosophy. And he seems to use it both ways in the things I've read. But these traditions existed in the Sokoto Caliphate. He was taught them. He seems to have taught them himself. But perhaps they existed in a hostile environment, given the nature of some of his vows. Did the tradition end with Dantafa? Did his students continue to teach this? These are things that require further research. So in future, I hope to acquire and translate more of his works of falsafa and attempt to track down their sources, what he studied in order to write these works, and the possible transmission of them. Thank you very much.
And our last speaker is Farah El-Sharif.
I think we've reached the midway point of the conference, and I think I speak on behalf of many in the room in saying it's been such a treat to listen to such captivating, original, and very exciting research. Like, my head is spinning. There's just so much very, very rich stuff that came up. So it's a very big honor for me as a lowly PhD student to follow at the heels of such distinguished faculty and scholars. But I'll do my best. So in fact, it's very exciting. My paper feels like a confluence of a lot of the themes that have been discussed so far today. I was feeling a little bit hesitant about choosing a small stream instead of taking the whole floodgate of the text at hand, which is al-Rimāh by Shaykh al-Fūti. I was hesitant to do so because I felt like it may have been too narrow. But in the world of, you know, visions and dreams and saints, I think things work out better than we expect, in the sense that though this is a mystical text, it touches on themes of readapting Maliki law, which was the previous panel on Islamic law touched on, many of you touched on in many different forms. So that will be a key theme going forward. And of course, Professor Zachary Wright's paper on visionary knowledge and encounters with the prophets is very much in line with the epistemology that I will discuss in this paper. And so I thank him for expertly fleshing out the world of visions and encounters with the prophets, because if you keep this in mind, my paper will be much easier to follow through. To introduce a little bit Shaykh al-Hajj ʿUmar bin Sa'id al-Fūti, who Professor Khan yesterday spoke about in his keynote, who died in 1864. He was among the most prominent West African figures of the Tariqa Tijaniya Sufi order in the 19th century. More about his military campaigns has been written than his status as a serious alim and spiritual giant, though thankfully efforts have begun in recent years by scholars in the West to remedy this false perception. In fact, Radke writes about the Rimāh in 1995, saying it would require a chitik to unpack all of its many, many layers. No, I'm no chitik, but at least I am taking a very small, humble part of it and try to dissect it in this paper. So the full name is the Kitāb Rimāh Hizb al-Rahīm ʿAlā Nuḥūr Hizb al-Rajīm, which would translate to the Book of the Spears of the League of Allah the Merciful against the necks of the League of Satan the Accursed. So I'll come back to the very tone of this text. It's very forceful, much like the author himself in his character was. And I argue that there is a philosophy behind this sort of violent description for what he's trying to do in this text. So this text, as Professor Khan yesterday mentioned, is normally written on the margins of another very seminal Tijani text, that is Ali Harazim's Jawahir al-Ma'ani. And yes, the Rimāh is a Sufi text. But in it, however, al-Fūti discusses a range of topics from fiqh to theology and cites more than 650 direct quotes from over 100 sources. One can say that it offers a whole worldview, and it is a thorough compendium for belief and worship. I argue that it is in its essence a reformist text, reformist in the sense of islah, that it is meant to rouse the reader from a slumber of complacency and error. Hajj ʿUmar uses the third person throughout the text. His chapters are entitled Informing Them That, or Warning Them This, or Tell Them That. So it is clearly a text of corrective guidance. And yet, one cannot simply dismiss al-Fūti as a mystic, unconcerned with the law and its relationship to Sufism. Many of the experts here in the room know that in the 18th and 19th centuries in North and West Africa, from Ahmad Zarruq to Ahmad ibn Idris, we find many such debates on the efforts to define the balance between tariqah and sharia, and attempts to define the cohesive idea of a juridical scholastic Sufism that emphasizes the importance of the many branches of fiqh and critiques the certain excesses of certain Sufi practices. As a product of that time that was rife with such debates, Hajj ʿUmar would add his own view on these matters in al-Rimāh. A key issue in my paper is his own opinion on the issue of following a madhab, which I will focus on for this presentation. In his chapter 8 is entitled, Informing Them That God Most High Did Not Make It Obligatory for anyone to adhere exclusively to a specific madhab of the mujtahideen, and informing them that every imam of this community, may God Most High be pleased with them all, has renounced any claim that men must necessarily follow them exclusively in every religious matter, since the imams know that unqualified fidelity is due only to him who is guarded from error, al-Ma'sum, the prophet. His negative position on the madhahib is by no means novel or shocking for his time, nor is it particularly original. It is actually reminiscent of his contemporary, the great mystic Ahmad ibn Idris al-Fasi, died 1837. The great Sufi who was dubbed Muhyi al-Sunnah, who, crazily enough, left Fas and moved to Arabian Peninsula to escape his home community for the excesses he witnessed in their reliance on taqlid in North Africa. And he chose, he elected, to live with the community of Abdul Wahhab, the founder of the Wahhabiyya movement, despite the Wahhabiyya's staunch opposition to Sufism, of course. But both Ibn Idris and Abdul Wahhab converged on one key point, and that is their rejection of absolute taqlid of the imams of the four madhabs and the act of following a single madhab. So in the Rimāh, it is clear that the same holds true for Hajj ʿUmar, who is also a proponent, of a return to the Qur'an and Sunnah only, and not to blindly follow adjudication by way of taqlid, and those he calls the imams of ijtihad, of the four legal schools. Interestingly, he calls them taqlid a'immat al-ijtihad, and previously in Professor Ismail's presentation, he quoted Sherman Jackson, who says, is the ijtihad of the muqallidun. So this is, in a sense, the inverse of Sherman Jackson's description. Anyhow, so the emphasis here is that Allah did not obligate anyone to follow a madhab exclusively, not an all-out rejection of the madhahib or the legal canon. The circumstances that arose to this position historically are kind of unclear. Sheikh Tijani was a Maliki, and a good number of his followers are, and they're spiritual descendants of that tradition. It is even likely, I think, that the overarching madhab of Fūti himself was Maliki, but it is possible he did not follow it exclusively or to the T. And yet, similar stances by earlier Sufis are seen in different texts, turuq, and regions. So why did Hajj ʿUmar take this stance? It could be one of the following scenarios. Either A, he witnessed excesses by the followers of some of the madhahib and the followers of the tariqah, or he was influenced by Wahhabi stances on this issue, which is less likely, although possible, since he visited the Hijaz for Hajj during Wahhabi rule. But I argue that it's little less those factors and more of the following. The Tariqah Tijaniya itself elevates this debate on this issue. Maybe it is a combination of the above factors, but more to do with the latter. And the simple fact that we take for granted or have a simplistic view about the unchallenged obligation of following a madhab for anti-Salafi traditionalist Sunnis today. I argue that al-Fūti's stance against the extremist and blind taqlid of the jurists translates into a call for believers to be more diligent about obtaining ma'rifah, superior knowledge, and thus establishing an intimate connection with the Prophet, the source of the Sunnah, the primary source of Sharia, along with the Qur'an. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ is the living Qur'an, and therefore he is the spring source of sacred law itself. Now, when a person has an intimate connection with a sacred law in waking visions or in dreams, then you can understand the agency and the power behind that. But I will come back to that since it's a contested space. So in secondary literature on Islamic modernism, and like Professor Solomon challenged, you know, these tropes of how we talk about Salafism and Islamic modernism, reform, etc., anti-madhabism has often been normatively paired with Salafi ideology. Modern and contemporary Sufis, on the other hand, of at least as our contemporaries of the Sunni Ash'ari elite of Damascus and Cairo, they have been among the strongest proponents of following a madhab exclusively, going so far as to say it is this normative Sunni practice that each of you must follow a madhab. Many of us are familiar with Rahmatullah Sheikh Ramadan Sa'id al-Buti, the Syrian contemporary Sheikh, who penned a text that says, "Alla madhabiyya akbar bid'a tuhaddid al-hadara al-islamiyya." So it is a very normative accepted trope that it is the largest innovation not to follow a madhab. And yet centuries before, you see al-Fūti saying it is a bid'ah to follow a madhab. So this is a very interesting debate that is ongoing, but it's really solidified and died out in the 20th century. So Hajj Omar's text, I say, complicates this narrative. Sufis of the 18th century also critiqued the blind prevalence of taqlid, but to the likes of Hajj Omar, a return to the Quran and Sunnah only meant something rather different than from the likes of Abdul Wahhab and his adherents. For Sufis like Hajj Omar, Quran and Sunnah only can in fact be read as not as a restriction, but as an invitation for a more dedicated, sincere, and serious form of wayfaring and worship with regards to the attainment of external legal knowledge as intrinsic to a mystically rigorous journey. In my paper and the title of this presentation, I probe the idea of Sunnah as a perpetual open source, whereby the Prophet's physical death in 1632, for some 18th century mystics like Tijani, al-Fūti, and other adherents of the Tariqah Muhammadiyya, did not signify the end of a direct juridical access to the Prophet. There are examples of Tijanis asking the Prophet directly about the validity of weak hadiths, or ask him to verify a form of worship, or end the debate on such and such in a vision or in a waking state. Now, this brings about the theme of conceit or this elitism that Professor Wright pointed out to us, that Tijanis have this reputation of having this sense of esoteric superiority because of this, you know, elite access. But he is not quite saying here that this is an old boys club that only we have access. On the contrary, this world has an etiquette and a secrecy to it, and it is not an open, free-for-all sort of open source in the computer geek sense where people go and in democratic digital space where anyone can edit at their own discretion. But more, I argue, in simply speaking, a source that is just not closed. It is an open source in the sense that it's not closed off. It is a source that can be accessed through hidayah, guidance, being chosen, exerting oneself, or otherwise. That the Tijanis believe is not only possible, but it is a promise. And it is the very basis of the Tijani haqiqa, the reality of the Tijaniya. And let me backtrack a little bit. So I argue that the feature of seeing the Prophet, yaqazatan la manama, in a waking state, shed its garb of secrecy, of being an elitist mystical secret, and became a normative feature of 18th and 19th century West and North African Sufism. After all, prophetic access is the basis on which the Tijaniyya was founded, and continues to be a source of ongoing guidance, starting with Ahmed Tijani and subsequent leaders and followers of the Tariqah to this day. So am I saying that Hajj Omar somehow advocates that prophetic access in visions somehow is a legal methodology? Absolutely not. He clearly does not say that, and nowhere in his text does he say that. In fact, as I said, there is an etiquette to these visions, and normally they entail permission from the receiver of the vision to even share this knowledge in public with others. But it points out to an elevated understanding in the relationship between ma'rifah and the law. In a sense, the Rimāh invites for a new reading of Islamic modernism and legal reform, and scholars of this field have long neglected 19th century West Africa as a ripe space for understanding alternative forms of Islamic modernism. While al-Rimāh is almost doctrinal in its language and structure, it predates the simplistic dichotomy of today's polemics, you know, Sufi versus Salafi, as unyieldingly opposed spheres. It complicates this narrative. One can even say that Hajj Omar's critique of excess taqlid offers a point of convergence and dialogue with what became the wide-spanning Wahhabi ideology in the 20th and 21st century. So just like Ibn Idris found a place of convergence, though he was a mystic, I argue the same can be true for questions of reform with so-called the big bad Salafi that Sufis don't talk to or engage. But there can be, in fact, a place of convergence. I'd like to talk about a specific way in which I probe this idea of legal knowledge from mystical experience. Similar tropes of al-Rimāh extend to the 21st century. The great Tijani Shaykh Ibrahim Nias, he's Shaykh al-Islam, Sahib al-Fayda. He himself, like Ahmad Tijani before him and many in that region, were known Malikis, but they went against certain Maliki practice in preference of the most perfect Muhammadan Sunnah. One such issue is the issue of qabd, praying with your hands folded, is one such example. You would be hard-pressed to find a Maliki in that region before the 40s, or even outside Sheikh Ibrahim Nias's community, praying like this. Malikis would pray with their hands to the side, that's called sadl, and the folding them would be called qabd. And it is said that, so Professor Wright actually expounds on this, the genealogy of this whole story in his book, The Living Knowledge in West African Islam. And he points us to the fact that Sheikh Ibrahim Nias's position on the madhahib is the following, is that one cannot follow one of the four imams blindly because this can shield someone from benefiting from a living sheikh, since most people cannot master all four madhahib and their rulings. There is even a saying attributed to Sheikh Ibrahim Nias who says, نَحْنُ مَالِكِيَّةَ لَكِنَّنَا لَسْنُ مَمَالِكَ لِمَالِكَ. We are Malikis, but we are not slaves of Imam Malik. In this sense, Wright, Professor Wright, reminds us that the higher goal of the law, according to the Tijaniya, is the knowledge of God, whether in the external rituals of worship or spiritual wayfaring. So in this way, we go beyond the dichotomy that law and spirit are not in opposition. Of course, this is true for the Sufis and specifically for the Tijanis of that time. But it offers us a new dimension that adjudicating as close as possible to the Sharia is intrinsically tied to one's spiritual state first and his closeness to the Prophet. For readers of modern Islamic intellectual history of reform, texts like al-Rimāh invite us to dig a little bit deeper into the history of ijtihad and its many manifestations. Indeed, for Hajj ʿUmar, not all mujtahids are created equal. Certainly, a Wahhabi mujtahid who rejects Sufism is rather unlike a Tijani mujtahid. We see this reality manifested in earlier texts, such as the great mystical text Al-Ibriz by Dabbagh, who died 1719, which al-Fūti quotes in his al-Rimāh. Please allow me to read this quote because it's very interesting. And know, may Allah guide you to goodness, that the wali who has achieved complete opening knows what is the truth and what is correct, and therefore does not stick to one madhab only. In fact, if all madhabs were finished, he would still be able to revive the sharia. And how not when the Prophet himself is not absent from him, even for the blink of an eye, and he is not absent from witnessing Allah, even for a moment. So therefore, he would know the intent of the Prophet and the intent of Allah in the prescribed duties of the Sharia and other matters. Subsequently, if he is like that, i.e. if he has this status, then he has authority over others and not vice versa. As he is closer to the truth than the one with no opening. Consequently then, how can it be correct to criticize such a saintly person by saying, oh, he went against this madhab in this issue or that. Completely elementary to people like Dabbagh and al-Fūti quibbling over madhab. They're way, way beyond that. End quote. So that wasn't him, that was me. Hajj ʿUmar is similarly dumbfounded in his tone throughout the al-Rimāh. In one section, he even calls people who deny the possibility of seeing the Prophet in a waking state, he says they are ignorant, stupid, envious, accursed seekers. He is not beating around the bush with secrecy and apologetics here. It tells us a lot about the type of alim he was, fiery and relentless. The title, going back to the title, of Rimah itself, lances or spears against the devil, tells us that he does not plan on mincing his words. It goes beyond the elementary discussions on law versus spirit. Indeed, to Hajj Omar, such a binary would seem absurd. This goes beyond that. In his text, we can clearly see the larger implications of his Sufi-oriented prescriptions. With the experiential knowledge of God at its epicenter, al-Rimāh points to an elevated epistemology for approaching the sacred law. In other words, Sufis make for better jurists. It is the learned friends of God who are better equipped to adapt legal rulings over the passage of time, negotiate difference and disagreement with ihsan and justice, and most of all, they are able to disseminate more sound knowledge of the Sharia through direct access to the Prophet, a still living embodiment of the Sunnah. Well, imagine being able to verify a hadith that the late Salafi Shaykh Albani in Syria, for example, how he closed the deal on that, and then have a Tijani mystic tell him, well, actually, the Prophet told me that it's not quite what you describe. I mean, it's powerful. But of course, again, this cannot be made into law or enter the legal corpus or canon due to accusations of bid'ah and respect for the 1,400-year-long tradition, legal tradition. This is why mystics like Dabbagh and al-Fūti and what they revealed in their text is so potent and contentious. But if we take what they say as a point of convergence rather than a place of contention, when all is done, Hajj Omar's calls for anti-madhabism, or shall we say beyond madhabism, is not meant to restrict or obliterate the history of the Islamic legal tradition. Quite the contrary. It is meant to water it with experiential access to the Sunnah Muhammadiyya and enrich it with a floodgate of knowledge from the greatest source, the Prophet himself. Thank you.
Let me just make a few comments before I open it up to questions, and we'll have about 15 or 20 minutes for questions to allow something for biological break between this session and the next session. Each of the paper givers rightly thanked the organizers of this conference, Usman Khan and Matthew Steele, for making the conditions possible for everyone coming together. But I want to be the first to thank the four paper presenters for what they've done together and given to us, because I believe that what they've done is given us something that is more than the sum of its parts, and that there's a larger kind of possibility that is emerging. I also want to say that I think that their papers have been exemplary in the manner in which they've approached their different topics. Once it was a case that a scholar could express both indebtedness to the past and a sense of the awareness of how much we depended on the past by saying that a scholar stood on the shoulders of giants. We still have to say such a statement, we stand on the shoulders of giants, but we live in a time in which we also realize that part of what we inherit is preventing us from doing the things that we see that we need to do. In old Irish epic literature, there's a hero named Cuchulainn, in which among his many virtues was that he was able to tie his shoes while running. And what we could say is that each of these four scholars in their papers have been tying their shoes while running. They're moving us ahead, but they're also fixing something that will, in some way, make us fall down if we don't attend to it. It's very, very hard to do. And I was just watching the elegance, the gentleness, the sophistication with which each one of them did that. We would just say, oh, it's exemplary for everyone, not only in the study of Islam in sub-Saharan Africa or Islamic studies, but generally in the study of everything that humans do and the way that we understand it based on what others have said before us. I just want to draw our attention to something in the title of the panel, Authors, Texts, and Islamic Scholarship. And one of the things that listening to the papers, what I began to wonder about is, and to notice that each of the paper givers seemed to understand Islamic scholarship in a slightly different way, and some listening to each other and how it might come together. One clear way is that Islamic scholarship is something of a received heritage, a tradition in which individual authors are embedded in it, building on it, adding to it in the text that they make. But in recent years, in all kinds of fields of scholarship, there's been a turn to go from the study of, say, art history, literary history, to the study of literary cultures, visual cultures. And we could see something similar here, particularly in Noah Solomon when he invoked an idea of a textual culture. We could say also in Mario Nobili that in his own paper, what we see is that it's not enough to just look at a textual culture. We see other kinds of cultures in play, and they begin to multiply in front of our eyes. We have a textual culture. We clearly have literary culture. People are writing poetry. We have religious cultures of various kinds of interactions. And we also have political culture. And how we see Islamic scholarship in some sense bringing together and asking us to see these things in interaction with each other is the same, something similar, I think, to the way that we ask when we attend to something like intertextuality. We could say, well, what we're seeing here in Islamic scholarship, something like making up a word, interculturality, or something, of how these things are coming together. But what the turn to looking at Islamic scholarship, not just as an inert received tradition that people then use and build upon, but as something producing something in its own right. What we quickly notice is that it produces the two elements in the title of the session, authors and texts. Cultures produce both persons and texts. And when we start to notice that both persons and texts are produced, it changes how we think about authors, which we see them both as agents in their own right and products of something else. And we're asking, what is it that's producing them? And once we acknowledge that, we end up also noticing that the other elements in the title, texts, have the same quality. They are functioning both as products that people make. And then we get ourselves into some conceptual trouble, at least ontologically, in which we say, oh, texts are agents too. We have all kinds of verbs that were attached to them. Texts intervene, texts do this. And so then we say, yes, they seem to be like people, but how can we think that? But it seems that we have to find a way of talking about that it's not just persons producing texts, but texts are producing persons, and that they are intervening into the lives of persons, and the people who are engaging them know that. And they're producing texts that can do that. The last thing I want to note that I found myself quite entranced by is the movements of mind of the different paper givers as they kind of interacted with the material that they were sharing with us. Let me just quote something that Noah Solomon quoted from Abd al-Karim Zaidan, that faith, it is faith that makes the absent as if it were present. And he drew our attention that in terms of Salafi textual culture, that faith was a prerequisite to engaging a text. The idea of something that is brought to engaging a text makes the absent as if it were present, I think is at the very heart of historical scholarship. There's some attitude that the scholar brings to the text that allows the text to be more than just inert, but that something that is not present in the text begins to become present to the eyes of the scholar. Oftentimes, what we have is, we could say, a probative attitude to the text. Like we saw with Mario Nobili, that he's suspicious of what the text says that it is or what people have said about it, that we have to be suspicious of that in order to see the other thing that is present there, but appears to us to be absent. And so this probative attitude that the scholars bring ran through all of the papers. And so we could say, oh, for scholars quite often, it is to be probative, to question, to be suspicious is what makes the absent as if it were present. But we might also say, oh, can we learn from Salafi textual culture and say that there has to be something else analogous to faith and what it would be for the scholar to have something like faith, in which we say, oh, we want to cultivate that other kind of attitude that all the papers exemplify in terms of sharing in, participating in, allowing Salafi textual culture to intervene in the intersubjective networks of our own learning. and to destabilize not only Salafi notions of a text or sub-Saharan African notions of a text, but to destabilize our own notions of a text. So with that, let me turn it, open it up to questions and people to ask. So please.
And
could you translate for those?
Yeah, definitely. And Allah sent to those who are unlearned the prophets to teach them the Quran and the hikmah. Use the word hikmah in the Quran, the book which is the Quran and hikmah. And scholars, religious scholars, have understood the hikmah as the book is very clear, is the Quran. The hikmah, as they have understood the hikmah as the seerah and the sunnah of the prophet, the hadith and the sunnah. And how does that reinforce, that definition, reinforce or contradict what you, Sheikh Dantaba, definition of hikmah?
So some scholars may define hikmah that way, but there's a large tradition of defining hikmah in terms of the Greek heritage of philosophy. Hikmah is identical with philosophy in many contexts, many literary contexts. So Ibn Sina and other philosophers were called hakims. People who were masters of medicine or philosophy were often called hakims. So it depends on the context and the literary discourse in which you're operating. The ones in which Sheikh Dantafa is operating in these works are, he will identify as hikmah works of falsafa, works of like Avicennan, Aristotelian philosophy, and works of some occult sciences which seem to have some kind of Greek Neoplatonic origin. So hikmah is being used in a radically different way than the sense in which you referenced. So same word, different meanings.
Please.
Thank you. I like your presentation because that reminds us how the boundary in the Islamic thinking and in the Islamic praxis and also in knowledge are very, very strong. And it is a call to see this boundary in a way which is not rigid. Mm-hmm. And when you say, for example, that Al-Idrisi, Hajj Omar, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab, will add Salih Fulani, mm-hmm. all of where, I would say Salafi, yeah. But at the same time, Sufi. Yeah. And the one who was less Salafi would be Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab. Because he was madhab, he was for madhab, he was for madhab for Ahmad,
Muhammad,
and the other were not for madhab.
Yes.
So it's a speculation, but it's it helped us to see this thing in another way.
It's what keeps me up at night. So.
Identity between the Sufis and the Salafis. Mm. I would say there's also, the Obambi, some groups. Because I think, I always argue with some of my anthropologist colleagues, that especially in the West, they try to, when they are teaching or when they're in discussion, try to put forms to Salafism, from dress to, certain things that they do. But it's an interesting, I think, boundary that identity is sport in that, you know, Durban, and there are people, and I know, and I did some, also some research about it, so I was going to suggest that.
Thank you.
For your research.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
I see a lot of hands, but I'm going to demonstrate that I'm a very poor textual scholar, in which I looked at it and I saw that this panel goes from 2 to 4 p.m. And then when I looked at the end of the sessions program, it says that we are to end at 3:45 p.m. So like the poor scholar that I am, I just read the beginning and drew a conclusion, and then I got to the end and I had to tie my shoes while running and to just say, I think some of us may be needing to run. And I apologize for cutting short ability to ask questions, but just assume that there'll be other times in the break or at dinner tonight for people to ask. But in order for the whole conference to keep on schedule, we ask your indulgence of me and to say that we end now. Okay.